What is branding? It's a big umbrella term, but what does it really mean and why is it important to you? When I hear the term branding, I think about my work at GoDaddy, where my whole world is about bringing a brand to life. This session will help you build your brand everywhere that matters, online and off. To start us off, here's Pamela Slim, a pioneer in the movement of people leaving their corporate jobs to start their own companies. Pam is an award-winning author, speaker, business coach, and co-founder of the Main Street Learning Lab, where she coaches small business owners about how to grow and scale their businesses. She'll cover the importance of networking, referring, connecting, all of my favorite things, and looking beyond the obvious. You'll learn how to build your brand by teaming up with others who serve the same customers and present your business in a way that connects with that ideal customer. Pam will teach you how to choose the beacon for sharing your unique message and help you find the perfect referral partners who are often right in front of your nose. Like, who have you missed in your network? Pam, we're ready. Let us know how to stand out in a crowd.
Thanks, Emma. Good to be here today. I am so excited to present Brand Magic. Stand out by standing with a crowd. I am Pamela Slim, and let me give you a little bit of my background for context for today's presentation. I have been in business for 25 years that I just celebrated last month. The first 10 years of my business, I was a management consultant in Silicon Valley. And the last 15, I have been a business coach, both in early stage startup, as well as working with companies that are scaling. I'm also the author of 3 books. The first, Escape from Cubicle Nation, came out in 2009. My second book, Body of Work, came out in 2014. And my latest book comes out this next month in October of 2021. I am also the co-founder with my husband, Daryl, of this Main Street Learning Lab, where I am broadcasting from today, which is a small business learning lab that sits right in the middle of Main Street in Mesa, Arizona. And here at the lab, we host all kinds of different business events by our local small business owners, as well as to provide education and training and coaching to clients that are all over the world. For today's presentation, I'll be drawing on that experience of working with people to hopefully help you create a much stronger branding experience that really expands your audience. Today, we're gonna focus on 3 main things. First, to present your business in a way that immediately connects with your ideal clients or customers. The second is to choose what I call a beacon that I will define a little bit later, which is the way that you can be sharing your message and unique perspective in a place that really attracts your ideal customers. And then finally, to help you to find your perfect referral partners. Some of them might be right in front of you, right under your nose, and we're gonna find some very specific tactical ways in which you can identify these referral partners. I'd like to start with an experience that I had as a customer of an orthodontist business called McDonald Orthodontics, which is here in Mesa, Arizona. Our middle son, Joshua, a couple years ago, was set to get braces, and I had a couple of specific concerns. The first was, how are we going to manage the monthly expenses? The second thing was just managing all of the different appointments amidst my and my husband's busy schedule, as well as my son's school schedule. So we were referred to this business by a trusted friend of our son, Josh, and his parents, and we went for a visit. And when it was time for them to sit down with us and present the options, they presented it in a very clear way. And then they said, would you like to put the braces on today? And I was a little bit shocked at that. I thought we'd have to go back to the front desk, set up another appointment. My husband and I looked at each other and we said, sure. So our son got his braces on that very day. In this experience, there were 2 things for me as a customer that were so exceptional. First, that it really felt like that offering was designed specifically for me. It's as if they were in my head and they knew exactly what was important to me. They addressed my most important issues, and it made it so easy to say yes to investing with that service. The second thing that was really important to me is that they came from a referral and a trusted source. We knew there was another family who had a positive experience working with them, and that made it easier for us to trust the fact that they would deliver an excellent service to us. So this specific example is part of what I want to work on with you so we can find out ways that your offerings are positioned in such a way that your customers feel like I felt when we went to McDonald Orthodontics. A central concept that we're going to work with in order to address that is a limiting thought that I know many of my clients have when they first start working with me. And that is this idea that they must be the best and only expert in their field in order to have a successful business. If somebody is a brand new coach, they may have that feeling when they're looking out into the field that there are many other coaches who have more experience. The same thing could be true if somebody wants to open a brick and mortar business like a restaurant. So you might have the intention to open a restaurant in a particular part of town, and when you visit, you can see other restaurants that are beautiful, that have a huge line of customers out the door. This can make you a little bit nervous of thinking about how you could open a successful business if you think that you have to have the only good restaurant on the block. This central idea is so important because there are many ways in which you can present your unique value to your audience without necessarily having to be the very best or only expert. Some of you might be feeling a little bit uncomfortable or thinking that what I mean is that you don't have to be excellent in your business. This is not the case. I want to assure you that to have a viable business, you need to have strong business ethics. You need to have excellent business operations. You need to have a great product or service that you feel proud to sell. Don't worry, that is an essential part of what we're talking about here. What I mean is there are other factors that we can define that allow you to reach a broader audience and to also feel really, really good about the unique value that you are delivering to your ideal customers. There are four core questions that we can ask as a first step to finding your, what I call, unique point of view. And what that means is, I think any business is centered around solving a specific problem for your customer or helping them to achieve a specific aspiration. Your point of view, your thought leadership, as some of you might have heard it called, is simply your specific perspective about how it is that you would solve that problem. In looking at how you can define it for your business, these are the four questions that you can ask, and we will give an example for each of them so you can see it in action. The first question is, what is missing from the conversation? Of all the people in your field that might be competitors that are addressing this core problem or helping your customers to achieve their aspiration, what do you find is missing from the conversation? Whose important perspective is not being shared? Question number three, what obvious truths are being ignored? And question number four, what critical steps are not being covered? Let's look at the first one. What is missing from the conversation? I want to use a personal example. When I was writing my book, Escape from Cubicle Nation, way back in 2008, I knew that for corporate employees that were considering leaving their job to start a business, there were some unspoken things that were really of concern that were holding people back from making the leap into entrepreneurship. And what I found those things to be were the emotional and psychological journey of shifting identities from being a corporate employee to being an entrepreneur. They were things like having to tell your parents, who had sacrificed so much in order to put you through college, that you are quitting your stable job at IBM in order to open your own cookie shop, or how it is that you could balance having a home office with also being productive. The second question, which is really important, is whose important perspective is not being shared? The example I want to use is Kimberly Bryant, who is the founder of Black Girls Code. And Kimberly described herself as a nerdy mom who was raising a geeky daughter. Her daughter was interested in learning to code. And as they explored some different programs, they found that most of the audience was really centered around white males. As Kimberly researched into the field, she found that 30 years ago, about 30% of the computer engineering graduates were women. This number had plummeted to about 12% of women in general and only 3% of women of color. She took that information and she designed a very specific program that was highlighting and centering the experience of herself as a Black computer engineer, and also of her daughter. And she has grown a really successful organization to support more women entering the field of computer engineering. The third question is, what obvious truths are being ignored? There is a fantastic book, if you haven't yet read it, and it is called Atomic Habits by James Clear. In that book, James uses very specific research to talk about how it is that we actually change our habits. So maybe we want to be more productive. Maybe we want to sleep better. Maybe we want to actually work on our business on a consistent basis. The research from Atomic Habits found that if you make a slight 1% change in your habit for an entire year, you're going to have 37 times the results, not percent, but times the results that you would had you not made that slight shift. An obvious truth that was missed is that you need to make really, really small habit changes. That's going to allow people to really sustain the change and can make the difference between successfully changing your habit or not. The fourth and final piece is, what critical steps are not being covered? Some of you, like me, may love podcasts. I love to listen as I'm driving into the Main Street Learning Lab in the morning. One of my very favorite is How I Built This with Guy Raz. Full disclosure, GoDaddy is a sponsor of that podcast. There always is a discussion about the most critical parts in the journey, some of which that were very difficult. Times where people maxed out their credit cards or had a really negative experience with a partner or struggled as they got new investors and they maybe had to leave the company. This very human part of the journey covers the kind of things that very often are skipped over as people are telling the stories of successful businesses. And you can know that also many of the bigger brands that you admire and their founders went through a similar experience. Looking at these factors in real life can give us examples like we live here every day on Main Street in Mesa. Organic Bean Company, which is founded by a mother-daughter pair, all of their products are organic. Everything from their coffee beans to all the different syrups to everything they use in their coffees. For people that really care about that, they're confident they can go to Organic Bean Company and get everything organic. Just a few steps down the road is the Nile, which is a totally vegan cafe. So they also serve coffee, but everything that they serve is all vegan. And yet again, just a couple steps down the block, Jared's is another cafe that has a lot more variety. Here in Arizona, it gets really hot in the summer if you haven't been here before. And so often they have really fun and unique blends of lemonades or iced teas. They also are in a space that is filled with art from neighborhood artists. And the experience is one that a lot of creative people really feel comfortable in. here on Main Street, there are all of these different options, and one would think that they would all be fighting to try to get customers to come their way. What we know on our Main Street, which I think is usually the same for Main Streets everywhere, is that having this healthy competition, places where different people can get their needs met, ends up making more people visit our downtown that helps everybody grow. Another example for those of you who might be in a service-based business is Adiola Mosanya is from Creatives Accountant, and she works with a lot of people who are self-identified creatives, graphic designers, writers, actors. She works with them to help to organize their finances in a way that doesn't feel overwhelming. Another really important player in the accounting world is author Mike Michalowicz. Some of you may have read his excellent book, Profit First. Mike trains other accountants and CPAs in this specific method of looking at the profit in your business, not just looking at the annual sales. In this space, there really is room. A lot of people, including Adiola, can be aware of Profit First, can use some of the concepts as she's working with her creative individuals, but it doesn't mean that there is not room for people to be following each of their work and getting great value for solving their core problem. What I would love for you to be thinking about for your own business is, what is the most relevant to your audience and your customers that you can really be addressing with your unique gifts and skills? This would be a fun thing, if you know already, to share in the chat. For people who aren't familiar with your business, you could let them know. Who knows? There could be a customer right there in the chat that would be a perfect fit for you. What really is the most important thing for your ideal customers? And then to make sure that you're really bringing some of your unique perspective and gifts to the brand experience. We have just covered the critical first part of figuring out how you're going to stand out in front of your ideal customers. And that is defining your unique point of view through the number of questions that we explored and the examples that we looked at from other businesses. The second important part is to choose your beacon. By beacon, what I mean is the primary communication vehicle that you use to communicate your thought leadership, to communicate your particular ideas for how you are helping your customers solve their problems or achieve their aspirations. Let's look at some different types of beacons. There are short-term temporary beacons, which I call pop-ups, and there are permanent beacons. For pop-ups, there can be a special event that is a one-time event that you are not going to be holding on a regular basis. There could be a one-time writing project, something like a three-part series to address a particular issue that your ideal customers face. There could be a limited speaking tour. And finally, you could do a webinar that's just a one-time webinar, either by yourself or with a partner, that could be a great pop-up beacon. For the permanent beacons, this is a critical part of your marketing operations. And this is where I encourage you to make some decisions about the beacon that you want to feature in your marketing plan. Beacons could be something like an email newsletter. You could have a podcast. Those of you who are Brené Brown fans, like I am, may notice that in the last couple of years, she's really centered most of her communication around creating a podcast as a beacon. You could also have a blog. That's how I started at Escape from Cubicle Nation. My blog was the way that I reached all of my initial clients in the first few years. You could also choose a primary social media satellite. Those of you on Facebook might know Humans of New York from Brandon Stanton. On Facebook, he shares photographs and stories of really interesting people in New York. And most of that is conveyed through Facebook. He has millions of followers on that site, and that has been a place then that has led to spin-off book deals and things like that. Then you can also have a brick and mortar beacon, which is what we have here at the Main Street Learning Lab, which is a physical space that becomes a central gathering point for your community. In choosing a beacon, it's important to look at these specific factors. The first is, what is the preferred communication vehicle for your ideal customer? In other words, where do they actually hang out? Where are they actively seeking information? That is paired with, what is your communication strength as a creator yourself? If, for example, you find that your ideal customers love to listen to podcasts like I do, but you really don't enjoy creating podcasts that you love to write, that's going to be a little bit of a mismatch. So in this case, if you, as the founder, don't really like that kind of communication vehicle or beacon, you may need to hire somebody on your staff that performs that function. Another really important decision criteria for choosing a beacon is, what do you own? Some of you active on social media, on TikTok or Instagram or Facebook, might see sometimes that creators develop a really huge audience and following, and then sometimes you can actually be kicked out of that environment for a whole variety of reasons. So you can actually own more of your beacon if you have something like your own email list where you have the emails of your customers, or something like a podcast. The other thing that can be important for a lot of folks in startup mode, especially if you're financing your business yourself, is, what are the costs that are involved in the beacon? Do you have to hire people to help you do things like editing your audio or in doing graphic design for your newsletter? It's important to build a budget and make sure that it fits and is cost effective. And then the final thing that goes very much with our theme about creating effective habits is, what is the beacon that you're likely to be the most consistent with? That's what's going to bring you joy. I have written my newsletter since 2004, and every time that I do it, I still get great joy in doing it. So it really allows me to stay consistent with that particular beacon in my business. All right. So you have your unique point of view. You've made a decision about what beacon you're going to be centering for your communication vehicle in your business. The third very important piece is finding your PB&J referral partners, peanut butter and jelly partners. And this is a fun name that I defined in order to look at another business owner who shares your ideal customer. They provide a service or they sell a product for that customer, and it is a highly complementary but non-competitive kind of partnership. When you can find these referral partners, this can absolutely open up opportunities for you to do co-marketing and to reach a much broader audience. There are five critical things to think about when finding your perfect PB&J partners. The first, as we've been talking about all during this session, is to define your audience by problem or opportunity. It's important, as you're first going through this exploration and trying to find some great referral partners, that you take your time. You want to date first. You don't want to jump head first into a partnership before you really know who the person is, if they're truly aligned with your values, and if they're going to treat your customers as well as you treat them. So make sure that you're really clear in defining, what are your partnership goals? Are you simply going to refer clients to each other? Do you want to do a little bit of co-marketing, like maybe doing a joint webinar on a shared topic? And then make sure you're testing the waters, that you get some experience of working with them with a number of different customers before maybe making it a more formal partnership. One fun way to begin to think about who a good peanut butter and jelly partner would be is just to think, if somebody needs this, then they probably need that. And that could be a little fun exercise that you're doing right now in chat, which is thinking about for yourself, if you provide a particular service, let's imagine that you are somebody who cleans pools. And so if you think, okay, my ideal customers are people who want to have a beautiful yard outside and might want to have a beautiful home in general. So if they need my pool cleaning services, if they need this, then what else would they need that would be complementary? They probably need a great landscaper. They could want to work with somebody who's an interior designer. And with this way to just quickly think about who are the other service providers they might work with, you have identified people that you could reach out and connect with that potentially could have scores or even hundreds of customers that would also be an ideal fit for you. This broader idea of ecosystems is a central idea in my latest book, The Widest Net, and you can start to see how exponentially you can begin to grow your business. In a couple concrete examples, like I was sharing with somebody who is cleaning pools, in the sector of the ecosystem around service providers, that's where you can be partnering with people like landscapers or interior designers. Another really valuable thing is finding events where you could be attending that also have some of these other ecosystem partners. Maybe there's a home and garden show that you could put up a booth in as a somebody who cleans pools, where you could also be connecting with ideal customers there in your local area or other people that are providing complimentary services. I really just want you to begin to think about this in a more expansive way, where you can identify what I call watering holes, which are just places in person and online where somebody else has gone through the hard work of gathering a lot of ideal customers in one place. As we can see, with looking at things a little bit differently, looking at with a unique point of view, making sure that you're choosing a beacon and communicating your valuable content in a way that's effective, and also looking for referral peanut butter and jelly partners, you can see that our initial thought that you must be the best person and the only person to be successful can really shift to the belief, which is you just have to be the most relevant and one of a strong group of experts in your field in order to have a successful business. This shift in my own experience means that I love to collaborate with people who are equally as passionate about helping my customers as I am. And I have so many incoming referrals from these partners, and I also refer a lot of people to them. These are some things to keep in mind as you begin to implement one small idea at a time. The first is, it's critical to create these authentic brand experiences. People really want to connect with you and your unique gifts and your unique ideas, and where you are helping them to solve the most important problem for them, that's going to make them feel like your business is perfectly designed for their needs. It also is critical to be an expert and to be trusted. As you begin to really dial into this idea of a beacon and to build your content strategy so that you have a clear way in which you're really signaling how people can solve their problems with your content and your ideas, this is something over time that's going to be gaining momentum. The last thing is to develop complementary partners. And there is just nothing that is going to drive more consistent growth than developing strong relationships with other people who offer complementary products or services for your ideal clients. Some great referral partnerships have started from your own experience as a customer being delighted by something that somebody is selling. If you want more resources, I wrote a blog post, What Personal Branding Experts Get Wrong. GoDaddy has written 5 proven ways to generate more business referrals. You can also get a complete audience building toolkit along with my brand new book. And finally, there is a GoDaddy community small business group for just networking in order to grow your business. Thank you so much, everyone, for your time and attention today. I hope that it's been helpful for you. This afternoon, I am co-hosting a networking table. Also, if you post about this event on social media, please tag GoDaddy using the hashtag GoDaddyOpen2021. And finally, you can join the GoDaddy community to continue the conversation at community.godaddy.com. It has been my joy and delight to be with you. I look forward to staying connected in the future.